Well, good morning again, everybody. Go ahead and take your Bible out and turn to the book of John, chapter 3, verse 16. And I'll be there in just a moment. You just kind of lay that in your lap. We're going to look at three verses of Scripture this morning. I want you to remember that God gave His one and His only Son. He didn't have but one. He had one, and His name was Jesus. He gave His one and only Son as a gift. Just out of curiosity, how many of y'all got a gift for Christmas? Okay. All right. I'm not going to ask how many of you got the gift you wanted. I just asked if you actually got a gift. He gave a gift to people of faith who can be, so that we can be released from the condemnation of sin that is in us. This is one of those very, very, very special Christmases where Christmas Day and Sunday wind up at the same time together, okay? And it really kind of throws a kink in our system and the things we do around here, but we consider that to be a really special time. Now, the last time that happened, who can remember what the last year that happened in? Do y'all remember? 2011, because I know, I Googled it. I went and you know if it's on Google, it's true, right? Okay, now I went and I Googled it. I found on Google that the last time it happened was 2011. And the next time that it's going to happen, are y'all ready for this? It's going to be 2022. Now, doesn't that sound like a long time away? Then it won't happen again, listen to this, until 2033. And what I did is I just assumed that it changed every day. It was just the next day each year because of the leap year. That kind of messes everything up. And for those of you who are really, really quirky and you like to know why things work the way that you are, there's a mathematical formula that figures this thing out. And it tells you that when I Googled it, this is what I found out. There's a pattern. And after the first one, then it's 6 years before it happens again. Then it's 11 years. Before it happens again, then it's 6 years before it happens again, and then it's 5 years again, and the whole cycle begins to start over. So I'm going to give you a test next week and ask how many of y'all can actually remember that. But I'm so blessed because you're here today. A lot of folks going to a lot of different places, but you, the church at Ridgely, you, the people of faith, you, the people who love Jesus Christ, are showing the world that your love for Jesus and for the body of Christ are of utmost importance to you. Thank you for being here. So important to you is it that you have even brought your friends and your family to come and be with you today. So that's a wonderful thing. And I know that getting here most likely was not easy for you to get here this morning. I know some of you probably got up at 3:30 this morning to open Christmas gifts, and some of you stayed up last night so you could open Christmas gifts. And by the look on some of the young people squirming in here, I'm thinking there's some Christmas gifts that have not yet been opened and will be later on the day. So I know it was hard for you to get here. May God bless you and keep may you keep Jesus the center of your Christmas celebration today. Speaking of gifts today, I want to talk about the greatest gift that's ever been given, and that is the gift of Jesus Christ Himself that God gave to you and me. So let's look in our Bible. Let's look at our text. John 3:16-18, where it said, "For God loved the world in this way," or you King James, "For God so loved the world, He gave His one and only Son," or His only begotten Son, so that everyone who believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. And then it goes on and it says, "For God did not send His Son," meaning Jesus, "into the world that He might condemn the world." Get your brain to thinking. "But that the world might be saved through Him." That was what His purpose was when He came. And in verse 18, it tells us our plight right here. "Anyone who believes in Him is not condemned." By the way, how many of y'all believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? He rose from the grave. He lives forevermore. And He's Lord of your life. Okay? "Anyone who believes in Him is not condemned. But anyone who does not believe in Him is already condemned. Because he has not believed in the name of the one and the only Son of God." And all God's people said. Amen. Okay. Perhaps the most famous text that there ever has been that the most people know is John 3:16, and I know it's the most well-known, and I quote it a lot when I preach. A lot of times you'll hear me when I'm getting ready to summarize the message at the end, you'll hear John 3:16, and you know, and I bet you if we did a poll in here, I would find out that 80% of the people in the auditorium right now could quote probably the King James or one of the other versions of, in fact, I'm going to have everybody stand up one by one and say, see, no, I'm just kidding. I'm not going to do that. But most of you in here could do that. I know all of the regular attenders have heard it so much it's implanted in your brain because it's such a meaningful verse. And John 3, 16, 17, and 18, though, we're gonna see the gift that God gave. And then we're going to talk just a little bit about our plight. You know, we're in a situation. We're not, when we come into this world, we're not where we need to be. And then we're going to talk about a key, and the key that releases this condemnation from us that causes us to have problems in our lives. So let's start off with the gift of God. Everybody say, the gift of God. The gift of God. For God loved the world in this way, he gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. Now, every Christmas, millions upon millions of dollars are spent on gifts for loved ones. Now, you probably set you a budget and you decided what you're going to get for everybody and you just went and thought about what's the perfect gift that you could give. Now, have you ever thought much about that and maybe asked this question? Why do we give gifts at Christmas? Now, the world gives gifts, if it's going to be Jesus' birthday, and he's the one that we're celebrating, and we celebrate the difference, and it's his birthday. Why is it that we give gifts to everybody else instead of bringing a gift to him to give to him? So why do we do it that way? Why do we give gifts at Christmas? Now, I want you to understand why the world gives gifts. The world gives gifts, and I have come to this conclusion because I have a degree in business administration, and I studied marketing, and I have come to the conclusion that the real people that give the gifts that they give in the world today, not the church, but in the world today, give it because of good marketing schemes. How many of y'all have ever seen a commercial? Aren't they everywhere? I mean, you pull up your computer, there's commercials on there. You ever notice you can look on Facebook? You can go on your computer and you can look up a product and you go back to your Facebook page or something, or you go look up something on the internet or you Google something, and all of a sudden the thing that you looked at appears on the very page right in front. It's almost scary, isn't it? Well, the truth is that's how good marketing has become. They don't create something that you need and try to sell it to you. They create something that they can create and make money off of. Then they convince you that you need what it is that they have and cause you to take it. And what has happened is in the marketing world, Christmas just gets way out of whack, and people from all different directions are going and buying and giving and trying to make sure that they find just that perfect gift for them. It's not that way for the people who know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. What followers of Jesus do is we give them because it is Jesus' birthday, or at least it's the day that we've set aside to celebrate Jesus' birthday. Some may ask, well, if it's Jesus' birthday, why are we giving each other gifts instead of just giving them to Jesus? Now, Jesus, as God's Son, and here's the reason we do this. Jesus is God's Son. He owns everything. This church is his, and the railroad out there that you had to cross, many of you had to cross across to get here, or the highway that you came down here, it all belongs to God. The heavens, everything turns up belonging to God. It would be like this. If we were going to give a gift to God, this is exactly the way this thing would work. It would be like we walked into God's house, okay? We come up the steps, you know, we walk in the door, and we sit down, and we say, oh no, I need to bring a gift to God. I came to his house, and I don't have a gift. So what in the world am I going to do? So you look around in the house and you see this set of coasters that are really fancy and they're sitting on the coffee table, and you run over there and you grab them and you grab some colorful paper from somewhere and you wrap it up all, and you get it like in a little bag or something. You make it all pretty and you go back to God and you say, God, I'm so glad I got to come to your house. Here is a wonderful Christmas present for you. And he opens it up and he looks inside and here's this pack of coasters that he has. Now, would God be pleased with that? Oh, God loves you as his child, and he's happy when you bring something back to him. But you know, there's nothing that God needs. So that's why we don't turn around and just give Jesus a gift on that. The reason we give gifts is to emulate, to be a mirror, to be a reflection of giving gifts, just like God gave to us his Son. We give gifts to people to remember what Jesus has done to them. Jesus is God's Son, owns everything, so we give gifts to reflect that glory. For the people, it would be like me coming over to your house and just taking one of your gifts and giving them. But for the people of God, we give those gifts to reflect the glory of God. Now, Jesus is God's gift to you. He's the one and only Son. There no more, never have been another one, never will be another one. He's the only single Son of God. No one except God, listen, ever gave his Son to a people that he knew would brutally murder him and kill him and take his life. No one but God has ever done that. Jesus is the essence of God, and he is God become flesh. God is spirit, but when God chose to make himself flesh, he became a man, and that man is Jesus, so that he could be a lamb who could be sacrificed to take away the sins of all people who believe in him and follow him. So God sent his Son to come to earth so that he could wind up being the sacrifice that would be there to take away your sins. The God of the universe, I want you to think about this. The God of the universe searched the universe, and the gift he chose to give you was his one and only Son. Now you stop and think about the people in your life that you love, and how over the last few weeks or months you've been plotting in your head the thing that you wanted to give them, to express to them the kind of love that you have for them. Well, God did the exact same thing for you. Long before you were ever born, before you were ever knitted together inside of your mother's womb, he sat back and he thought, what is the best gift that I could ever give them? And after he thought, he came to the conclusion that Jesus Christ, his very own Son, God himself, would be his gift to you. You ever give somebody a gift, and when they open it up, they go, oh, gee, I really got three of these already, you know, or whatever. Everybody, when somebody unwraps the gift, they want the other person to go, you know, I hope you got that for Christmas. I got it a few times. I missed it a few times along the way. But everybody wants that gift. Well, when Jesus was given to the world, sometimes the world says, oh, well, yeah. But people of faith don't do that. They say, oh, great God. You know, God could have sent anything he wanted. He could have sent Buddha. He could have sent Muhammad. He could have sent Sung Young Moon. But he didn't. He sent his Son, because it had to be the perfect Lamb of God. And why did it have to be the perfect Lamb of God? Because you and I are wretched sinners. Which brings me to my second thought this morning. I want to talk about the plight of man. When I say the plight of man, I mean the plight of woman. I mean the plight of everybody who is here. Look at what it says in John 3:17. In John 3:17, when I talk about the plight of man, what I'm saying is, for God did not send his Son into the world that he might condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. God did not send Jesus into the world to condemn the world. That's not his process. That's not what he was doing with Jesus when he came the first time. Jesus did not come to condemn you, because you have already condemned yourself. How many of y'all remember when you were born? Okay, nobody remembers that, but I want you to know that you were the most self-centered little child. Whenever you wanted something to eat, you just cried and whined, and then you just pooped in your britches, and you cried and you whined. So then you got a little bit older, and then you took everything away from everybody, and you said, mine, 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 mine. You know, who teaches children to be selfish? And the answer to that question is, we come into this world with a selfish nature. And you and I did, and all of the children in the world come that way. But we all, God didn't send his Son to condemn the world, because the world was already condemned. Your selfishness and my selfishness, you're not Christ-like. You're not who you're supposed to be in Christ Jesus. You have lust for sex. Some of us are greedy. Some people have all the accomplishments, and they find everything. And they find out that their goodness is in their accomplishment. The problem is we're nothing like we're supposed to be. So Jesus didn't have to come to the world to condemn us, because we've already done a real good job of condemning ourselves. You look across the room, you'll see people, and you recognize their sins immediately, but I'm going to ask you not to look across the room and see their sins immediately. I want you to look at your own self for a minute. You know, if you were to take out the Ten Commandments right now and go down the list one by one, how many of them would you have failed? Thou shalt have no other God. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. Some of you love stuff, things, people, you know, more than you do God. everyone has enough self-perspective to see that they're imperfect. Doesn't take very long to come to that conclusion. Just like it says in Romans 3:23, we have all sinned and fall short of God's glory. God sees all. He knows all. And since he's an all-seeing and an all-knowing God, he knows your all-sinful condition. He knows your sinful nature even better than you know your sinful nature. Yet, he still loves you. And how much does he love you? He loved you so much that he was willing to have those crown of thorns placed upon Jesus' head. He was allowing them to beat Jesus with the cat of nine tails because he loves you so much. He is offering you forgiveness through his son Jesus' substitutionary death. You see, they should have hung. You and I ought to be the ones that hang on the cross. But it was Jesus, God's son, who took our place. We should be condemned to hell, but by faith, God removes the condemnation. You know, there's two places people are going to spend eternity. One is heaven and the other is hell. For those who stand condemned and have nobody to remove the condemnation, they will spend an eternity in hell because they're selfish. But for those of us who have come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we found the key to eternal life. Which brings me to my third point right here. I want to say that my third thing I want to talk to you about this morning is the key to the release of condemnation is faith. Everybody say faith. Faith. Now, Miss Faith, they're not talking to you right now, okay? All right, faith. All right, everybody say faith. Say it one more time. Faith. It's coming in. Okay, anyone who believes in him is not condemned. Now, the word belief right there is not just to say that I really believe it exists. To believe in him means that I believe so much that I'm going to do whatever he tells me to do. I'm going to come and I'm going to follow him. Everyone who believes in him is not condemned, but everyone who does not believe is already condemned because he has not believed in the name of the one and only Son. Jesus did not come to condemn the world, but he came to make a way to escape the condemnation by providing a key to release the guilt of your sin and to open the door of heaven. Okay, imagine if you would just a little bitty key right here, an old-fashioned key. You know, the one's got the little teeth that come down, and that key has the power to reach down and unlock the chains of sin that you have in your life. And when you have faith, remember faith is a key. When you have faith in Jesus Christ, that key unlocks that sinful nature. It unlocks that selfishness that you have in you, and you can walk away from that sinful nature. But not only does it unlock that sinful nature, whenever you get ready to die and your life, you take the last breath, you have that key with you, and you walk into heaven, you can insert it in the door of heaven and unlock that door and open it up, and you get to walk right into heaven because you have faith. The metaphorical key that I'm speaking of today unlocks both the chains of sin and the door that leads into heaven. Without the key, you'll never find either one of those things. If you want to have victory over an addiction, you'll never find victory over the addiction. What you do is you let Jesus have victory over you through faith, and as that happens, then you begin to walk and live the way he wants you to live. When you die, you will never make it into heaven without the faith that you must have. It releases the guilt of sin, and it guarantees entrance into heaven where people will eternally be with God in a land of glorious perfection. Now, Jesus has to explain this to somebody. I think I have a picture of the original Nicodemus. Y'all believe that's really Nicodemus from the Old Testament? Sounds good. Okay, it's not really Nicodemus, but if I ever had to pick a picture of Nicodemus, that guy looks like Nicodemus right there. Nicodemus was a guy that came to Jesus at night. There's a man who's a leader of the Jews. He's on the Sanhedrin. He's got a lot of influential power, and he comes to Jesus at night. And the reason he comes to Jesus at night is because he doesn't want anybody to know that he's coming to Jesus, you see, because if he did, it would cost him greatly. So this man, Nicodemus, was a leader of the Jews. He was a member of the Sanhedrin, and his name is Nicodemus. And after having seen Jesus do these miracles, turning water into wine and touching the sick people and healing them, and all of these miracles passing before him, he decided he needed to come to Jesus. So he came to him in the middle of the night. And this is the question that he asked him. He says, "What must I do to have eternal life? I don't want to be condemned and go to hell. I want to live on in eternity." And this question is what prompted Jesus to speak our text back to him today. That text that you know so well, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, and whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life," was spoken because Nicodemus went and had that conversation with Jesus. And then Jesus explains to Nicodemus that he must experience a spiritual rebirth. And it just blows Nicodemus' mind. I almost can see Nicodemus' head go and it'd be exploded. And he says, what do you mean be born again? Can I jump back up inside my mama and have birth all over again? And Jesus begins to explain to him, that's not the way it was. Nicodemus must have looked quite perplexed, because Jesus said, and this is what Jesus says. He says, no one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. The Son of Man was Jesus' favorite description of himself. And what he was saying was, the only way you're going to know that heaven really exists is if somebody went to heaven, took a look around, comprehended everything that was going on in heaven, came back down to us in physical form, and told us that heaven really existed. And by the way, has anybody ever done that? And what was his name? Jesus. Jesus was saying to Nicodemus, look, Nicodemus, not only have I been here, but I've been up in heaven. And I've walked around. I've been with the seraphim. I've been with all the angels. I've been there, and I've seen God the Father, and I have a conversation with him on a regular basis. In fact, I've come down here to earth just to tell you that it really does exist. And by the way, you got a problem with your sin. He was explaining that he was God's Son who came from heaven to testify to the existence and to give the key that he needed to have to unlock the door which he must pass to get eternal life. You see, the key is faith, as we talked about a while ago. Faith in Jesus as the one and only Son of God. And there's not another, there's only Jesus. Nicodemus must have thought long and hard about what was taking place. Now, Nicodemus didn't just immediately make a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. What he did was he went back to the Sanhedrin. He went back to his regular, ordinary life. And as they began to argue about things, he would listen. But there was one night when he stands up, once before Jesus was crucified, once before they came to get him, the temple police were sent out to go and get Jesus and bring him before him. The temple police went out and they came back and they asked him, you know, why didn't you go ahead and arrest Jesus? And that's when Nicodemus stops. He says, wait a minute, let's stop right here. Let's stop what we're saying. And Nicodemus says, does our law condemn a man before you even give him a chance to talk about and to tell us what's going on with him? Nicodemus was taking a first little step to stand up for Jesus. But then it was years later, after Jesus was crucified, that Nicodemus was the very one who went with Joseph of Arimathea. When Jesus had died and they placed him in a tomb, Nicodemus brought 75 pounds of spices with him, and he didn't care who saw him, because he was coming to anoint the body of the one who had explained eternal life to him. By faith, Nicodemus stepped away from the crowd, and he took the key that unlocks the guilt of sin, and he opened the door of eternal life. God loves you so much that he gave his one and only Son that you could have eternal life. God loves you so much that he's given you a gift, which is the key of faith. But if you're going to have the key of faith, you got to have sense enough to open the gift. And when you receive that faith that he's offering to you, you can take that key. You can unlock the chains of sin, become the person that God wants you to become, and you can live your life. And when you get to heaven, you got a key to get into eternal life. Who's got the key? The only people who have the key are the ones who have sense enough to know that they've sinned and fall short of God's glory. Because God demonstrated his love for us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Because we've all sinned and fall short of God's glory. And the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Because God loved you so much that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. In the book of Revelation, we hear where Jesus knocks on the door and he says, behold, I stand on the door and knock. If any man will open the door, I will come in. If any man or any woman wants to open the door, they got to take out the key of faith unlock the door and let Jesus come in. Is there anybody here today that needs a key of faith? You decide in your mind that you're going to have faith and God will do an amazing thing. Now take the Holy Spirit planted in your heart and you'll be just like Nicodemus. Before too long, not only will you be standing up for Jesus, you'll be walking with Jesus and you'll spend everything you have to let him know how much you love him. After you've seen that he gave his life for you, you'll be willing to give your life for him. Let's pray to God. God, thank you for your grace and mercy.